Hello and welcome to the next installment of the Little Pot of Horrors, the best idea since premarital sex on Halloween. As always, I am Goggs, and as always, I am joined by Mr. Boz. Hello, sir.
Hello, how are you?
I'm good, thank you very much. Yourself?
Not bad.
Good, good, good. Sorry, yes, go ahead.
I was going to ask how you survived last weekend, because we were going to record last weekend, and this was a bit of a gap.
Yes.
Because you nearly had a Wizard of Oz experience, I believe.
Almost. They had been talking about the major storms that were going to be cutting through our area for about 4 days in advance, to which I'd been completely oblivious because I don't really pay attention to the weather, especially in November, because when someone mentions tornadoes in November, you're like, yeah, right, whatever.
Yeah.
And on the Saturday, we kind of really took things a bit serious when we looked at the entire state of Indiana was in the greatest tornado risk category. And people were saying, hey, getting a great risk category in regular tornado season is rare. Getting it in November is extremely rare. So please do not take this lightly.
Yeah.
Weather forecasting over here is amazing. It's a bit different than the guy just standing in front of a map and throwing up a sun when it gets to like the northern Scotland. Yeah. These guys take it incredibly seriously. So, obviously, because tornadoes and hurricanes and everything and all these storms are deadly. So, they don't want to have anybody kind of losing their life on their watch. So, they take things incredibly seriously. So, they were hounding us the day before.
What?
So, I was saying, and I get freaked out. So, I do. This is all still relatively new to me. And I have kids and everything. I want everybody to be safe. So, I took this one really seriously as well. So, we had everything all packed up, all ready to go. We had all the preparations down in the cellar, ready to go. Flashlights, change of clothes, medicine, everything, just in case we'd leave and everything got blown away. And Sunday came, we watched TV. Obviously, I cancelled the recording with you. We're watching TV all day. The one day I could watch the frickin' Grand Prix. The one bloody day. It's on NBC. They're going to show the US Grand Prix. I was so excited, and it fucking couldn't watch hardly any of it because of damn weather coverage. But we were really lucky. I mean, we were watching the clips coming in from places in Illinois and stuff that were just destroyed. Some places that were just immense. It came down to us. We got a bit of a storm earlier. It pissed out of rain in the morning. We got like 4 inches of rain in an hour in the morning, so we were flooded out anyway. Fortunately, managed to clear the cellar out before that. But it went right round us. We were so lucky. It's done this a lot, so I'm touching wood because one of these times it's not. I think we must be in the right little valley or whatever. But we
might be something to do with that huge pentagram on your front door. I don't know.
Possibly. But I mean, it got dark. The rain came on. The rain was coming on horizontal, and then it stopped. And I've been told that ain't a good sign. If it stops just that quickly. It's kind of the calm before the storm.
Yeah.
But now we were watching it and we were hearing the weather guy saying, hey, we've got a radar reported of a funnel cloud to like 10 miles to the north of us, and there was nothing reported there. And then they were saying, hang on a second, south of Elizabeth, we're now getting radar reports again of another funnel cloud. If everybody in Elizabeth could look out their windows and tell us what the hell's going on. And I was like, shit, what the hell's going on? we couldn't see anything. So the radar reports were potentially false, or we just couldn't get, nobody could get pictures of it, but we got lucky.
It was close enough to shit you up for the day, though.
It did, it completely. My entire day was not ruined, but I just spent glued to the TV and keeping all the kids around and making sure everything was safe. But we weren't affected this area, but people north, Indiana, kind of central Indiana and Illinois and stuff, they got hit pretty bad in places. So, and people, if you haven't seen what a tornado can do, go online and look at what it can do. And these are the reasons these weather guys take it seriously.
Yeah.
So they do. I remember they cut into the State of the Union a couple of years ago.
Really?
The weather guy was like, I have never had to cut the president off in my life, but we're issuing a tornado watch. Stop now and get to your safe place.
Bloody hell.
Yeah, these guys take weather really seriously over here, and they can predict it. You can't predict the funnel cloud's going to come down, but they can predict it's going to get bad. Really, really well. And I heard lots of people complaining the next day going, oh, they took it all a bit extreme, blah, blah, blah. And I was a bit like, well, yeah, but that's their job and We get off lightly.
You have me worried anyway.
Yes, sorry.
Well, you will move to these strange places. What was wrong with Edinburgh, eh?
I know.
What's wrong with the haggis? Hmm? Sorry.
Oh, it's okay. You've just annihilated all of our Edinburgh listeners.
Sorry, Andrew.
It's more than Andrew. Yeah, we've got lots of people liking us. So we do.
Well, there's a segue for you. Yes, it is, we have.
We've got this all planned out. I think the last time we recorded, or maybe the time before, we had like 40-something people who liked us on Facebook.
Because
we know there's a lot more of you out there that actually like us, but you're just too shy to come over and tell us. Mm. But as of recording, I think we're 205.
Bloody hell.
Which has exploded huge amounts.
That's been in like 2 weeks, isn't it?
It has really, in the last 2 or 3 weeks, it's just exploded. Pretty Amazing. Much since Halloween. there's been a lot of internal sharing between everybody, plus also a little bit of Facebook helping us out, shall we say. Mm.
Yeah.
Which we're not going to complain at. So thank you, Facebook. You're doing something good for me. Hmm. But yes, so hopefully it tunes in a lot more people to the show if they haven't previously listened to it. So hello if you're new. Hi.
I'm sorry if it's a massive disappointment.
Yes, we don't always talk about weather to begin with, but we like to talk about our own things. So hi.
Read the tagline, it gives it away.
On related notes of social media, we are pretty much everywhere now, people. There has been a lot of work done the last couple of weeks to try and not increase, or basically get out there as much as we can on all platforms, so that you've no excuses not to be listening.
Yeah.
And for a lot, try and see if we can increase the audience through different media. So we are now on SoundCloud.
We are.
Which has just got all the episodes from just the Little Pot of Horrors. It doesn't have any of the older episodes from the previous incarnation on there.
Okay.
I might drop them on at some point just as a little bit of fun.
Hmm.
But we are on there, and there'll be a link on the page, which is still at Podbean at the moment.
There's what we like about SoundCloud is there's a SoundCloud iOS and I believe Android app, and you can just subscribe to things through that, and then it puts us in your pocket, basically, which makes things a lot easier.
Exactly. And it's a really cool little app. So it does, and you can also download. I've clicked a little download function there as well, so if you don't want to do streaming, you can do the download from there too.
Yeah.
That was nice to use. so yeah, you'll find the link on, I've posted it on Facebook, and you can go to the site, littlepotofhorrors.com, and you'll find links there, because it is pretty much soundcloud.com, the-little-pod-of-horrors, which doesn't really roll off the tongue.
it kind of dashes off the tongue.
Yes.
Kill me now.
And we're also on a kind of radio / network called Stitcher, which is pretty much like SoundCloud, but you can't download it. So it's just another way of accessing us. Because if you're anything like my work, they haven't quite blocked all these little streaming websites yet. So if I can't get on SoundCloud, I can usually get on another one. So we find all ways to circumvent all these firewalls.
Yeah.
And that link is completely weird, so I'm not even going to bother telling people what that is. You're just going to have to go out and click on it if you want to do it. But they've got an app as well, and it's pretty cool how you can do anything. So one of our listeners put us onto that, and we signed up for that, so thank you.
Brilliant.
And then also you put the shout out there for more iTunes reviews. So please, please, please.
Yeah, the thing with the iTunes reviews is if you want the only way you get any kind of exposure on there is by getting reviews and ratings, just a star rating. If you're not getting any of that, it never seems to be based on subscriptions or how many people are downloading, or it's the weirdest system in the world. But currently we don't really appear anywhere, so I just thought, well, if we're trying to increase the show's exposure, that's one way of doing it. So if you have got a spare 5 minutes, I think now you can just click a few stars. You don't have to write a review necessary, although if you want to tell us how much we drone on, then that's the place. No, that's not the place to do it. You should lie there, tell everyone we're amazing, and then write to us privately and tell us how shit we are. That's exactly. That's what we'd prefer.
That's the way to do it. That's the very British way to do it. But we do have some reviews on there, so one of which a guy left as a piece of, saying as an email, which we'll get into in a minute, but we have a couple of reviews on the US store from Todd and the Admiral, and there's some on the UK store.
Yeah, we've got two on there as well. Last time I looked, that may have changed.
It's kind of difficult. Sometimes iTunes lets me look into other country stores, and sometimes it doesn't. It just gets a little bit temperamental at times. So we will be continuing to check people.
Yeah.
So please do. And if you want a shout-out, go on there and leave a review, and we'll shout out for you.
Yeah.
Just in case you might have wondered by now, I am sounding a little bit different.
Yes, yeah, so your dulcet tones are far more sexy and dulcet.
Yes. Well, hopefully it works out in the edit. That's because, thanks to some lovely listeners out there who've actually donated money to us to put towards the show, I went out and bought a new microphone to hopefully make it sound a little bit better, as my previous microphone was getting very hissy at times and was picking up way too much background noise. So hopefully this new recording setup is going to work for us. I'm going to be tweaking it as we go along, because it turns out that Skype rules everything on my computer. So if I don't keep Skype happy, all my recording setups are just completely out the window. So there will be tweaking and things going along.
Exactly. We but don't want the mic and the host going hissy, do we?
No, we don't. So to those people who shall remain nameless, thank you very much for your generous contributions towards the show.
Yeah.
Really appreciate it. It does help keep the lights on. Thank you.
Marvellous.
Yours.
Housekeeping done.
Tick. And now we'll jump on to a little piece of feedback. We got an email. We've had lots of feedback on the Facebook site. We could probably record 4 hours worth of show.
We could.
Just on the Facebook site. I mean, it's exploding over there with people leaving little posts and stuff, and it's amazing. So, again, if you haven't liked us, or even if you do like us and don't really go onto the page, go over there and check out the comments and stuff that people are reading. And there's trailers getting put over there. We're putting lots of little bits and pieces on. So please do go check that out.
Yeah, and not everybody posting agrees with us, which is, you know, even more interesting.
I know. I noticed Mr. Mark's comment about Relic was shite. I really haven't. Really?
So I had one as well about ABCs, so don't worry.
Yes.
Come and heckle us. We like some banter.
Oh, yeah. We can take it. And all it's doing is increasing my homework list, as I'm trying to make sure I reply to as much of the feedback as I can, as well as watch all these trailers and everything. So it's great. Please do go along, leave recommendations, trailers, etc. And doing that. So the quick piece of feedback we've got is from a gentleman who I mentioned, Todd, who also left us a review on iTunes. He just says, "Hey guys, I'm in construction and listen to podcasts at least 7 hours a day. I love your show. Once in a great while, I turn friends on to a new discovery. I've been spreading the love all over their faces and in their ears. A couple of things for Boz. I still enjoy the occasional brew dog, including a punk IPA the other night, and you must see Inside. It's a fucking blood-splattered masterpiece. More shows, please. Happy Halloween, Todd from Chicago."
Thanks, Todd. It's top. I swear it is now top of my list. I'm struggling to source it. As soon as I do, it's being watched, because I can't, you know, this list of top movies came out this week, and I'd seen most. That was the only one I hadn't seen. So, damn! I mean, it was a very French-biased list, I found.
Yes.
But it was like, oh, God, I could have scored 10 out of 10 then. But yeah, it is up there. And clearly somebody who's heard Here Goes Nothing once in his life, because he knows about the awesome that is Brewdog, my favourite beer in the world. But I'm afraid I can't do a woof clang on here, because this is not Here Goes Nothing.
So. We can't incorporate that.
Oh, no, that'd be shameless. And I'm shameless enough.
Oh, my God. See, look, you think we planned this out, because that's a nice little segue into being shameless. As people, we're going to run a competition.
Yes, we are.
We mentioned this a few shows ago, but we are finally ready to kick this off. And I'm going to hand this one over to you, sir.
Oh, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Right. We have a prize bundle. And this is funny. It's just clues in the name there. Two prizes, basically, and we were going to like do one for one, one for the other, but I think because we've only got one thing we're going to ask you to do, we're going to, you win everything, winner takes all. So the first thing is we have a humble bundle. Now, for those of you who don't know what that is, it's a collection of games put together by this amazing website, and you pay a one-off price and you get all these games, okay? Now, we've been donated a humble bundle, which includes two Dead Space games, which, as far as horror games, computer games go, are up there, really. I've got one and two, and they have shit me up on occasion. Just some very nasty, gribbly monsters and loads of blood, and you know, you can kill a monster and then go over to it and just continuously stamp on its remains until there's as little left as you want to leave before you walk away again.
No.
So it's pretty full-on gruesome. So there's that, and we will print you a T-shirt. It won't be personalised, but it will have the Pod of Horrors logo. It will, yeah, be shameless promotion for us, but hey, it's still a little Pod of Horrors T-shirt, and that logo, as designed by Ro Caron, is just amazing. So if you want to win that, the rules are... We would ask you a question, but we figured that's too mundane.
Yeah.
What we would like you to do is jot down, in not too many words, we don't want pages and pages of work and effort, but a concept, a horror film concept written like a film treatment. So it's just an outline of how the film would go, not a script, nothing too laid out. But with me and Gordon as the central characters, you could take us into space, you could take us to hell, whatever, but just a little outline of a story. It could be funny, it could be tragic, it could be gory, it could be completely over the top, but we just want you to have some fun doing it, and hopefully we'll have a giggle reading them. So that's our idea. Your cut-off date, I think we've decided, will be the end of the year, basically, so 31st of December, so you've got plenty of time.
Yep.
And just email this into us at thelittlepodofhorrors@gmail.com.
Yeah. And
winner takes all.
And we shall judge fairly.
Mm. I think we should read the top three.
Yes.
On the show.
Providing we get three.
Oh, you little faith. I have more faith in our listeners than that.
I do. I think we'll plug the shit out of this little competition so that everybody, for those people who don't listen regularly but save them up for marathons or whatever,
yeah,
so that we can make sure everybody's aware of it at least.
Yeah.
Because people, you do want to get a hold of one of these T-shirts. So you do. They're not going to be unique like Boz's and I's with the type.
I'm going to spell it mistake. No, they will not. They will not be like ours.
So they're not going to be of the very original batch run, which will be worth many, many thousands of dollars. Oh,
definitely.
At some point.
By Grabfast Hammer, they will be spelt correctly. Sorry, but, wrong genre.
Yeah, it is a wrong genre, yes, unfortunately. But yes, so please do send in something. Like I say, it can be as brief, as detailed, whatever you want. We're not asking for a minimum 1,000 words or anything no. like that. It's just whatever. Have some fun with it. Let's see what you come up with, and I'm sure there are a lot of very creative, ingenious people out there.
Yeah, Scott Sigler, if you're listening, you're not allowed to enter. You have an unfair advantage.
It's very true. What's next? Trick you up. Well, with that out of the way, shall we just jump into our usual what we've been watching?
Yes.
Because I got a lot.
I think you should go first.
You think I should go first? Okay, so that sounds as almost a boss doesn't have a lot there, people. It's all on me. So this is the GOG show again. I'll start off with one that I tried to watch and I gave up after 30 minutes. I couldn't make it any longer. I try, people. I will go back to it at some point because I've heard there is a very cool kill in it. Is it really horror? Is it sci-fi? Is it just bullshit? Yes, I'm talking Sharknado.
Hurricane David is poised to be the first hurricane.
It's a storm. It's what's driven them all up north.
I've never seen so many of them or so bold.
It's barely even raining.
It's flooding here. Not the plumbing, the ocean. You need to go home.
I'm not going anywhere.
Storm's coming and it's coming fast. Can't sit back and watch this.
Tornado's heading towards the airport. We need to destroy it before it gets to them. Watch out!
Can't just wait here and wait shark to rain down on us.
They throw bombs into the tornado.
It's too dangerous. Too many of them. We're gonna need a bigger chopper.
Claudia, move!
Time to leave Kansas, mate.
It is now on Netflix over in the US, and oh my god, is it bad? Oh my god, I'd need to be drunk. I tried to watch it sober on one of these kind of, I'm in a happy jolly mood on a Saturday afternoon. And I couldn't make it through half an hour.
I'm not sure alcohol is a strong enough substance, actually, to make it that bearable.
Oh, my God. It was just... I've been called out on Facebook for not making it all the way through it. But I'm sorry. Time was precious. I gave it 30 minutes, and that was like 28 minutes, maybe too long.
Well, the best bits are the beginning and the end anyway, because the bar stool use is brilliant.
Which was funny, yes.
Yeah, and we're going to need a bigger car, obviously. And then the chainsaw at the end, and flying a helicopter right next to a tornado, which of course you can do. Of course you can do that. And throw bombs in it. Oh, and then they'll stop, by the way. Oh, spoilers, sorry, I've done it again.
Damn it! Yeah, I just need to fast forward it for this chainsaw scene, because that was the one of the guy, when I told the guy at work, he was like, what? You didn't see the chainsaw scene? And I was like, no. And he's like, you have to. So
But I warn you, because now it's built up in your head, it is no face fucked with the chainsaw scene. I'm telling you now.
I know it's not. He's told me what happens in it, so. And having seen, I'm assuming it's a bit kind of Pacific Rimmy.
Yes.
Yeah, I can add. Next. I have got to watch a very unique perspective way of watching horror movies now. Because I'm in basketball season and I'm in the middle of a car park and waiting for my kids, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
I just watch it on... I bought a little DVD player, but I've been watching stuff on my iPhone.
Okay.
Other phones are available.
No, decent ones, though. Oh! Upset the Android community, I'm sorry.
Oh, we're going to get some feedback. But and with my little headphones in, because it's better. And I found that is the best way to watch horror movies.
It's brilliant.
Because it just really immerses you into what you're watching. You hear every little bit of sound and everything like that. So I think from now on, movie theatres should have the option of plugging in headphones. So
that would be such a good idea.
Wouldn't it?
Such a good idea.
Because then you wouldn't have to listen to the annoying little fuckers a couple of rows over talking or whatever like that. You
can just do like aeroplane seats.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So...
Noise-cancelling headphones, then no rustly crisp packets.
Yep. I don't ask for a lot of money from when that happens, but if it does, I just ask for, like, free cinema for life. I think that's fair.
Yeah.
I think that's fair. I don't go very often. For both of us. We want free cinema for life for both of us. And you have to call it the little pod of headphones or something like that.
Yeah.
For all you marketing geniuses out there, listen. So that's been a great way for me to watch it, and it's actually made me a little bit creepier.
Yes.
Because
especially spooky movies.
Yes.
Ghosty ones are brilliant like that.
Yes. So I watched two movies in this fashion. One of which I'm not really going to talk about too much because it was me catching up on my homework for what we set the Admiral.
Oh, okay.
Because I'd never watched The Woman in Black.
Oh, great way to do that.
But I started off the week watching The Ring because it was like a 99 cent horror on iTunes. I thought, hey, I'm going to download that. Perfect.
And had you never seen it?
I had watched it in the cinema when it first came out.
Hmm.
And then I think I tried to watch it again on DVD because I bought it and fell asleep. Which, it wasn't anything to do with the movie that I fell asleep. It was just one of those lazy Sunday afternoons and it's too nice and warm and cozy under the duvet and kind of thing.
Yeah.
So catching up with it again. Wow. I'd forgotten just how much the ending fucked me off. Fucked me up.
Yes.
I knew it was coming because I could remember some bits, but damn. Yeah. Well, the headphones definitely helped with the sound.
Yeah, I'll bet.
Getting in there and freaking me the hell out. If you haven't seen The Ring, people, it's a very... Oh, I don't really know. It's a very bizarre horror movie, and I haven't seen the original. I don't think I want to see the original.
I think it's one of those where the remake's actually probably better.
I have heard people say that, but I'm not quite sure.
I actually have to... I recently watched Ju-on, The Grudge. Okay.
Yeah.
And I have to say the American remake of that is creepier. Definitely.
Really?
Because the way they use the effects and stuff...
Okay.
I think they had a much smaller budget for the original, and yeah, the concept was creepy, but also... That sort of lost in translation bit we often get, I think making it more understandable for a Western audience actually helped make it creepier as well.
Right, okay.
But I may just be, it may, you know, because if I'd watched them the other way around, I might have hated the remake.
Right.
So, I don't know really, but a lot of the scares in the remake were genuinely really freaky. And actually the remake of The Noise.
Oh.
I can't do it. Anyway.
That's pretty good.
It's way hard, way scarier in the remake as well. That. Send your hate mail too.
Oh, we're going to get loads this week. But no, I mean, I didn't really freak me out until the very end. Having seen it before, I knew what was coming.
Yeah.
Or I tried to remember what was coming. Because I was like, oh, when does this bit come in? When does this bit come in? And I kept getting it wrong in the order of events. But if you don't know anything about it, it is basically, you watch this movie and this VHS, and you, at the end of it, you get a phone call that tells you, you've got 7 days. And at the end of those 7 days, pretty much to the minute, you die.
Yeah.
Have you heard about this videotape that kills you when you watch it? You start to play it, and it's like somebody's nightmare. And as soon as it's over, your phone rings. And what they say is, you will die in 7 days. I've watched it. It was a week ago. I spoke to 3 different doctors, and not one of them could tell me exactly what happened to my daughter. You could find out. It's what you do, isn't it? Ask questions.
Show it to me.
Why did you draw that house?
He told me to. Who told you to?
The little girl.
There you go, that's it. And it's about Naomi Watts trying to get to the bottom of this story and also not kill herself or not have herself die as she stupidly watched it. Dumbass. Yeah. If someone tells you you watch this, you're gonna die, don't watch it. There you go, end the movie. And don't be put off by the fact that it's directed by Gore Verbinski. Which I completely forgot. Yeah, I didn't realise that until the end, and it popped up, and I went, holy shit. Yeah.
Oh, weird. Right then.
So you could make some good movies.
Actually, I have to point at this point, somebody did put a link, I'm sure it was on our Facebook page, God, I hope it was, if not, I hope I reposted it. It was a trailer for the film, the fictional film called Hell No. Did you get to watch that?
I haven't watched that yet, no, but it was posted on there. I think Rob posted it on, or I think it was Rob, I can't remember.
Yeah, it's one of these... what if everybody in these horror films wasn't stupid?
Oh, so no, it came from the Admiral. I'm thinking of something else. Yes.
So it's like, hey, I know what you do tonight. We'll watch this VHS and then you might die in 3 days. The guy goes, oh, really? Great, give it me. And he gives it to him. He just rips it up, throws it on the floor and stamps on it. That's what you should have done.
Yeah, no, there's lots of people were posting that on Facebook and I think I saw it on the Admiral's.
Oh, okay. It's really funny.
But yeah, it's like 3 minutes long. It's hilarious, people. It's exactly everything you would do in real life.
It's like, hey, me and the rest of the cheerleaders are going up to this creepy old abandoned house tonight to get really, really drunk. Do you want to come? No. No. Brilliant.
It is very good.
We've all thought it.
Yes. Now, the other one I watched, it was in this fashion, was The Woman in Black.
Mm.
I don't want to talk about it too much because I'd rather wait till we have the Admiral on board. And
yeah, leave it.
We can leave it.
I want to watch it again before that anyway. So
okay, cool.
Just to refresh my memory.
But it was the perfect way to watch that movie.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it was. If you haven't watched it yet, people, and you want to watch it before we discuss it with the Admiral, which will be in a few weeks' time. Mm. Unfortunately, he could have been on this week's show, but he's got a life and he's out on a date with his wife. So, you know.
That's just not good enough.
I know. It's all about. But he is going to watch this. Nope. He is out to watch the Scottish play, though. So.
Oh, that's all right.
There you go. So I'll let him off with that one. But no, please try and check it out beforehand. And if you can, I'm telling you, watch it in an environment where you will not be disturbed. You can turn out all the lights and have the volume turned up as high as you can. You will not regret it. Get as close to cinema experience as you can. Okay. And then I did another one where I might go back and finish watching this if I can come over my anger. Going through my iTunes store purchases from many, many years ago, I found one called The Children, which at some point I think somebody had recommended this to me from 2008. It's a British horror.
Now this is heaven.
I want to reach in to the phone, pull those people out, and beat the absolute living shit out of each and every one of them. I fucking hate the characters in this. Absolutely fucking hate every single one of them. They all deserve to die. I wish the kids would just hurry up and kill them. I'm sick of waiting now for all the death scenes to happen. I just want it to fucking happen.
Fast forward. That's what it's invented for.
Oh, my God. God, they're the most irritating adults and teenage girl in the world. This fucking writing on this is shocking. The acting is shocking.
Did you press a button by mistake? Did you happen to just put on an episode of EastEnders and not realise?
No, I didn't.
Okay. That tends to be my exact reaction to that pile of crap.
So. Oh, no, it's... I think I had watched it all the way through before when I first got it, but I can't remember much as to how it ends. But one of the very weird things in it is it keeps reminding me of the Infected series.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because they have been infected by something, and it looks as though they've got some sort of kind of telepathy type thing going on. So I kept getting reminded a little bit of that. I can't remember how it plays out or why these kids... Basically, what happens is two families get together and all the kids just start becoming weird. And then I think they turn around and kill the adults. There's no real spoiler there because it's pretty much... It should be a gimme from the fact it's called The Children.
Yes.
So you don't really see anything how it happens and how this I'm going to class it as infection in quotations... comes about and just affects the kids only. So it kind of made me think about that little series of books. To which I have still not finished, unfortunately. I'm about 60-something percent through Contagious.
Well, you've got to pace yourself till January. So, not January, April, I think.
But three movies I did watch in the space of a day. I was on a bit of a pur. I was about to say a bit of a
binge.
No, binge. That's the word.
Binge and purge. Binge is the first bit.
The binge is the first bit, and the reason I was saying purge is because the purge is one of the movies that I watched.
Okay. Brilliant.
Yes. So pretty much, I caught up with three movies that I've been dying to see, and the purge was obviously one I had picked up with the trailer a lot.
Yeah.
And was really desperate to see this one.
And
oh my god, I give up. I give up. I've had it. I'm switching podcasts. I'm now going to come up with a different one. I'm going to go work on the Starbase for a little bit.
You should start a Disney podcast. Although
yes,
after last episode, I'm not sure that'd be a good idea.
I really wanted this to be so good. I really, really did.
It wasn't terrible.
No, it wasn't terrible, but it wasn't good. It was very rushed.
It was.
Towards the end. I mean, it's only 85 minutes long, so you take out all the credits and stuff, and you're only, 75 minutes, something like that, probably.
Mm.
Which it could have been doing with taking that extra 10 minutes or so, and there might be some spoilers in here, people, and if there are, then I apologise, but look at the show notes and or skip forward a few minutes. But when the real shit happens and they start invading the house, the end scenes where the neighbours come along and help, that just felt very, very rushed. Everybody just seemed to be getting picked off way too quickly. We'd spent, 20 minutes finding the homeless man that managed to hide in the house, and I think that was the wrong place to spend that time.
Yeah.
I don't know why they're trying to build up tension and stuff, trying to find this guy. It's like, what the fuck? Spend more time on the fact that you've got, 10... Abercrombie and Fitch preppy bastards outside that are trying to get in and kill you all. I mean, I know what you're trying to do, and or what they're trying to set up is give us this guy and we'll leave you alone. I think it'd be more interesting if you said, give us this guy. He found the guy, threw him outside, and he went, you know what? Fuck yous, we're still going to come in and get you.
Yeah.
Kind of thing. But the main bad guy, and he was pretty creepy. I think he talked about him being like a natural joker. He certainly has the mouth for it.
He certainly does.
But I mean, he died in a pussy way. Or sorry, a shrinky dick way. Or a really bad... I mean, his death was awful for me.
I can't remember, actually. It must be unmemorable.
The neighbours just came in and it was he was kind of walking over to the family and he was a bit oh, I'm going to get you now kind of thing. And then, boom, 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 he was shot by one of the neighbours. And you're really?
That's why I didn't remember.
That's it? That's kind of crap. Okay. Again, we're still in spoiler territory. So Ethan Hawke dies, which I thought was quite a nice little twist. Kill the daddy. I didn't see that coming.
No, I didn't actually.
But my wife had pretty much guessed the end of the movie within the first 4 minutes. I don't know how she did it because I didn't see the end coming with the neighbors actually turning on the family. But she guessed it.
The cookie exchange was so hostile. It was so hostile. I think I twigged actually at that point.
I wasn't really. Attention.
I think it was when it happened. I was not surprised. Actually,
yes.
Would be a more fair way to say it. But
So she twigged on that. Both her and I had kind of hoped that when the wife had said no more killing tonight, that she kind of waited for the last 30 seconds of the purge and just said fuck yous.
That would have been funnier.
That would have been the best way to end it.
But the glass table was cool.
It was. They did have some good bits.
Yeah.
But. Unfortunately, I have just seen and posted on Facebook last night that The Purge 2 now has a release date.
Oh, dear. That would be a DVD job for me, if anything. The thing is, I don't like home invasion movies anyway, so I gave this one a chance. And I didn't hate it, but at the same time, I wasn't gushing about it either. Whereas You're Next, I do hope that one, when you finally get your hands on it, will make up for this one.
Yeah, I hope so. I mean, I love home invasion. The Strangers... I absolutely adore.
Really? Oh, I haven't seen that yet.
Unfortunately for me, it's a one-timer. I tried to watch it again, and it loses all the impact because you know what's coming up. And The Purge tried to do some of those elements, I think, and failed. The Purge 2, just stop, people. Stop, stop, stop. This was a very original idea. You're now killing it on a second one. You don't need to. You could. This could become the next Saw, Paranormal Activity, whatever. All you got to do is just move it to a different state and have a different bunch of people killing people.
It's not really horror enough, though, is it? I found it's it more not. Of an action movie than anything. So.
Yeah, I think it could have been done. If they went down the Strangers route, it could have been more horror or more suspense and putting you on edge. But I was disappointed because of the people that was involved in it. But oh well.
Can't win them all.
No, you can't. I think I'll save this one for the last. I finished last night watching. I just had to do it. I had to do it. I'm sorry. It probably should be a B's for Boz section. but I had to watch Curse of Chucky.
I plan to watch it. I do. It's got to be done.
It does. I mean, I tried to watch Seed of Chucky and Bride of Chucky and got like 10 minutes into it and turned it off. And I probably should have done that with this one. It's what you get. I mean, it's a killer doll running around killing people in strange ways, and making you going, really? He's a fucking 2-foot-high doll. Seriously? I mean,
that's always been the case.
It has. So I mean, I don't know why I get surprised. I think they're going to go anywhere different with it.
Yeah.
The way they tie it up to the rest of the series was very cool. I like what they tried to do with it. I think. Unfortunately, they failed a little bit towards the end, where they tried to bring flashbacks into it and try and explain everything that was going on and tie it all up.
Mm.
I like Brad Dourif. I like his voice. I think Chucky's voice is very cool.
Yeah.
Good. It had some fun kills in it. It was a bit of a laugh.
That's what it's about.
Yeah. I wish I'd watched it in kind of Fright Fest with an audience, but
yeah,
a little fun thing.
Yeah.
There is some some unnecessary lesbianism in it, shall we say. Okay. Which is just hilarious. I'm like, really?
Crowbar in there.
Oh my god. but stick with it, people. Right, if you're going to watch it, stick with it right through the very end of the credits. It's worth it. It is worth it. That's all I'll say.
Okay.
And then here's the big one. The big one.
Yeah.
The Conjuring.
Yeah.
I did not watch this one in the correct setting.
Ah.
Unfortunately. I had really hoped to watch this at night time, but we ended up watching White House Down instead. Which, funnily, is a nice tie-in to this, because the daughter in White House Down is one of the daughters in The Conjuring. So,
oh, okay.
So I had a little bit of a tie-in. If you haven't seen White House Down, people, it's fucking hilarious.
I plan to see that.
Oh my god, it is amazing. My son and I just killed ourselves laughing for the last hour. It's fucking brilliant. It is. Now, this one I had heard a huge amount, not just because you talked about it and raved it up, but there's been a lot of talk on, again, listening to other film podcasts, bringing up Mark Kermode stuff again, is that people were talking about how this is a horror movie for non-horror fans, which I didn't quite understand.
No, well.
But before I watched it, anyway.
Okay.
But I'm assuming this is the thing that they're trying to say now, is they're trying to bring people into the horror genre, or...
I think
get more money out of people that traditionally wouldn't go to these horror types of movies, but they're trying to expand their profit margins. I thought this was really, really well done. I really liked it.
Oh, you did?
Yes, I did. And I really wish I had watched it in the ideal settings now, because I think it would have freaked me out a lot more than it did. I didn't get really many jumps out of it. I didn't get put on edge or anything like that. I can see kind of what they're saying, because there was an awful amount of cliched bits in this.
Yeah.
Which was fine.
But that's what James Wan does.
I wasn't expecting anything more.
Yeah, it's his horror style. He's the same with Insidious. And like you say, that's why people are saying it's for people who aren't horror fans, I think, because he's taking the old tropes, repackaging them, and going, look, this is how cool horror can be.
Yes.
And some people hate him for doing that, but I'm one of those who think, yeah, bring it. Get more people involved.
Oh, yeah. I mean, he did it really well. When all the shit happens, it was like, wow.
Yeah.
This is getting really dark. And it was the effects, the practical effects, and the CGI effects and everything were amazing. It was really making me think again at the end. I really wish that horror actors and actresses get a lot more credit for what they do.
Yeah.
Because there is no other genre out there that puts their actors through this level of...
stress.
Yeah. I mean, because the mother in this, I can't remember her name, and I've got it clicked on IMDb, and I can't remember. Lily Cut Taylor. I think that's the actress's name. Yeah, Lily Taylor. They put her through the ringer again.
Mm.
I may be a slight spoiler, but she goes through to hell and back, almost quite literally, in this movie. And I think she deserves like a big award for it.
Yeah.
Because she was very convincing, and I mean, like I say, it's all effects, people, but her or her stunt double gets thrown around a lot.
Yes.
And obviously with Evil Dead coming out this year and stuff, we know what the actresses and actors can get put through.
Mm.
But I just don't think they get anywhere near the credit they deserve for putting them through this. I mean, fucking, I haven't seen it, but Sandra Bullock flows around in, you know, Gravity, and she gets like all the Oscar plaudits.
Yeah.
What's that all about? I mean,
that's a bloody good point, you know, because if she gets an Oscar for that, I'll be a bit pissed, because there was nothing remarkable about her performance. I'm sorry, it just wasn't.
It's probably a topic for another show.
Mm.
But if you haven't seen The Conjuring, people, then check it out. It's not going to bring anything. It doesn't bring anything new to the genre, I don't think. Again, disappointed that The Conjuring 2 is in production.
That's sequels. It's a horror film. Achilles' heel is a sequel.
Yeah. It doesn't need to be. I think the ending wrapped up really well.
Mm.
And the last shot was a very nice last shot.
Although, the characters they have established there, the two who, you know, the based on a true story bit. The
Warrens, yeah.
The Warrens. Actually, they are sequel fodder, because you can put them in a completely different situation next time. As long as it's them, we're in, we'll watch. And you're not retreading the same ghost, the same house, the same... That's where, like, Insidious 2 lost me completely.
Yeah.
Because it was too much of the same from the first movie, and it was... There were some clever little tie-ins, but all in all, it was bollocks.
Yeah.
But this time, if they just... All I want to see is that couple, because I ended up really caring about that family as well.
Yeah.
There were two families, and it made you care about both of them and how it impacted both of them. And they've got a creepy fucking room full of really dangerous artifacts, and there's a lot you could do with that. So, yeah.
Oh, just God, yeah.
Thinking out loud there, I'm thinking, actually, I might be on board for a sequel. I'll be curious to see.
I would say it's definitely worth checking it out.
I would as well.
It's rated 7.6 on IMDb.
Well, that's good.
It's probably about right.
Hmm. Yeah, I'd agree with that.
But yeah, so that was pretty much me. Like I say, I was on a little bit of a binge, trying to catch up on some stuff, so...
Well,
I had a ball.
There was a little tie in there to what I've been watching, because I did go and see Gravity.
Yes.
And I'm going to talk about it on here, because there's a couple of little horror-y type bits, which I won't say, because I know loads of people haven't yet seen it and they want to go and see it, but there is a horror element to part of the film.
Okay.
And that particular bit was really well done, and I wasn't expecting it. And a family behind me had, like, I don't know, a 6- and 7-year-old kid with them or something, and they were noisy as they came, and I'm thinking, oh, God, why did you bring kids to this movie? Because I'm thinking, whatever happens, they're not going to be interested.
Yeah.
I prejudged them, and then this scene happened, and I'm sitting there thinking, ha-ha, they're going to have nightmares, and it's your fault. But then I started thinking, well, maybe a couple of horror fans are born, because that's how these things happen. Something freaks you out when you're that sort of age, and you're hooked. So I'm thinking, maybe I shouldn't be so judgmental. But then at the end of the film, I heard the parents turn to the kids and say, did you like that? They went, oh, yeah, it's really good. I loved it when blah, blah, blah. Again, okay, you knew your children. And that's what a 12A rating. You have to know your kids when you take them into these movies. And
yeah.
I know for a fact no fucking parent ever goes and watches it first, then takes the kids, because nobody can afford to do that. So they just take a punt based on the BBS, not the BBSA, that's the British Blind and Shutter Association. What are they called?
The BBFC.
BBFC, those guys.
Yes.
They don't talk about child cord safety on blinds. No.
Maybe they should.
No, people read that advice and take a punt on it. And actually, it seemed to pay off for these people. So I started thinking, Boz, don't be such a miserable old shit and judge other people. But given the hype, it was a little bit of a come down for me. That bit I really enjoyed. But then where it ended up, where it went and how it did it. Effects, brilliant. Production, brilliant. Direction's okay. This Hollywood ham and cheese on toast is really starting to piss me off. And I'm probably the only person around who didn't really go bonkers for Pacific Rim. I enjoyed it, but the script really put me off. And the fact that it was Guillermo that wrote the script put me off even more. Well, not put me off. I was disappointed because I couldn't believe that something that schlocky came from him. It was like, seriously, dude, you need to move away from America for a bit. Just collect your thoughts and go back to it, because Hollywood is not doing you any favours.
Big robots fighting
big robots
monsters.
Hitting monsters, brilliant. But the bloody plot and the humans, take all the humans out of it, it's fine.
Oh, God, yeah.
So, yeah, it suffers a bit from that. And after all the hype, I was like, it's good, but was that it really?
Yeah.
And I felt really bad saying that, because nobody else seemed to be saying it. So, and, you know, consider some of the shit I watch and really enjoy. It's a bit rich, really, isn't it? So that was that one. So back to my normal fare, which is basically Netflixy horror-type movies. Yeah. I watched one, which you'll have seen it probably on your list, is a picture of an eyeball. And anything with an eyeball, I'm thinking, could be interesting. And then I read the cast list, and it said Jeffrey Combs. And I'm like, well, if Herbert West's in it, I'm in for the ride on this one. Uh-huh. This is called Would You Rather, and it does what it says on the tin.
I know the name.
Yeah. Now, again, I will avoid spoilers because I don't think it's one a lot of people know about, and I did enjoy this one, so I would say go and see it. But it's basically a girl whose brother is ill. I think it's some kind of leukemia or whatever. Can't afford the medical bills. She's working hard to try and pay for it. Goes to see a doctor, and he introduces her to this creepy guy with a moustache, Jeffrey Combs. And he says, I run a foundation, I can help you. You come to a dinner, and you play a game. If you win the game, then you get all the treatment paid for. And the game is, would you rather do this, or would you rather do this? And obviously, it gets a little bit more extreme the more it goes on.
Right.
So... I don't actually want to say any of the would you rathers because they're all there to be experienced. Okay. It didn't go quite the way I was expecting, but I did guess the end, which is a little bit disappointing. But if you like Jeffrey Combs and you just want to watch him chew scenery for an hour and a half and just be odious on screen, which he does so well, just go watch it. You will love it. And if you don't, I don't know anything. But there we are. So that's that.
Iris Shepherd Lambert.
Dr. Barton's told me much about you. Your brother. He's quite sick.
You can help him.
I'm hosting a dinner party tomorrow night, and I'd like you to join us. Well, there'll be other guests there. People who just haven't received a fair shake in life. And the evening will culminate with a game.
A contest.
Each player will be given a choice between A or B.
What the hell is this?
Decision making in its rawest form. Would you rather electrocute yourself?
Oh no, I see where this is going.
Or?
I don't think I can do this here.
15 seconds. Go.
No. No, I can't do that.
You must make the decision. It's the game.
What the fuck is the matter with you people?
Would you rather...
Music! Fuck!
Light the fuse!
Anywhere? Quick question, does it go over the top at any point?
Not really, no.
Okay.
No. If anything, it's a lot more, it was more understated
okay.
than I was expecting.
Okay.
Yeah, it doesn't hit hostile sore territory at all.
Oh, right, okay. That's quite good then.
It plays with the mind a bit more.
Right.
And it's not particularly graphic either. It makes you think. You're like, ooh, ow, you know.
Okay.
But yeah, I don't want to say much more about it. And the other one I watched, which was on the list we mentioned earlier, the 10 greatest horror films, whatever it was, another French film called The Ordeal, or I can't remember what the French is. Sorry, Ordeal. Odile, not Ordeal. Okay. She's a friend of ours, who's a French teacher. So I'll just say. sorry, Odile, I didn't like the ordeal. And it really awful singer, shouldn't be singing to anybody, but people love him. Is going to another gig, takes a wrong turn, ends up in Creepy Village. Nice innkeeper takes him in and gives him a room and says, oh, we'll get your van fixed, we'll get your van fixed. The point at which the guy goes into his van and starts stealing things, you think, well, this isn't going very well.
Yeah.
Then it just goes fucking weird, and there's no payoff on this at all. The raving about it, I do not understand, and it just makes me think, well, I'm not a particular filmy type. I clearly don't watch films like a lot of other people, and it's maybe not guns and explosions enough. So, like I say, with this whole Pacific Rim's too cheesy and too obvious, you get a film like this which is clearly made to be divisive and subversive and make you uncomfortable, and I didn't like it. So I guess you just can't win with me, that's it.
Did you not like it because it was making you uncomfortable, or it wasn't doing enough?
No, it didn't make me uncomfortable enough. And I think it was trying to be, and it was trying to be really subversive, and I was a bit like, well, okay, I didn't see that coming, but it's like, I don't get why you would let that happen, and I don't know, just, there's a couple of things I'm thinking, well, the guy's such a, he's a waste of space, really.
So, okay.
I'm not surprised what happens to him does, but...
Right, okay.
It's nothing like High Tension, it's okay. nothing like Frontiers, even, so, Frontiers, I don't know, I did that with a Spanish accent, that was dreadful, cut that out. So... this leads us nicely into the other thing I did, was I went to the Leeds International Film Festival for one night only, but that one night was for Night of the Dead.